My name is Pastor Esta Rosario, and on behalf of Woodmar United Methodist Church, I welcome you to our online worship service in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Due to the high positivity rate of COVID cases in Lake County, we are continuing to worship online. So we ask for your prayers and your patience as we continue to navigate these tumultuous waters. It is my joy to share with you that our 2019 summer intern, MaryBeth Schneibel, is going to bring the word to us today. MaryBeth graduated from Lee University in May and began her Master's of Divinity at Asbury Theological Seminary in September. MaryBeth, it is such a blessing to have you with us again. Later in worship, we will be celebrating Holy Communion, so I invite you to hit pause and go to your kitchen and collect some communion elements, bread, crackers, juice, water, coffee, tea, whatever you'd like to use for communion later in worship. Let's prepare our hearts for worship now by hearing these words from the prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Snow. Hello there, Woodmar. What an absolute joy it is to get to be speaking with you here today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is MaryBeth Schneibel. I served as an intern of this church in the summer of 2019. So that was like 14 years ago, right? 2020 has happened since then, and what a year that was. I'm glad it's over. I don't know about you. And I feel such a privilege to be speaking with you on the very first Sunday of 2021. And I'm sitting here alone, but I can imagine that everybody in their individual homes is cheering or saying hallelujah to that, maybe doing some cartwheels. Just hearing that it is a new year feels like a weight lifted. I think if there's one thing that everyone has in common, it's that this last year was tough. We have all suffered a lot of loss in this past year, right? You know, maybe it's the loss of experiences due to the pandemic. Maybe it's the loss of loved ones or the loss of relationships or financial stability or of peace of mind. Though I'm excited to enter into this new year and I'm definitely hopeful that it will not be the same, I knew that it would be inauthentic of me to preach a message of new year, new beginnings, everything's great, as if all of the legitimately felt losses of 2020 are just going to magically disappear with the turn of the calendar. Because that's not realistic, right? And frankly, I don't really feel like that's what God wants from us. What God does want from us, and of this I'm certain, is that God wants our worship. And that worship doesn't necessarily have to look like a blind optimism, that everything's okay, but it may look more like being honest with God about where we're at and knowing that God's going to meet us in that place. So I have a couple of texts I wanted to look at with you today. So you may or may not know that today is Epiphany Sunday in a church calendar. That means that this is the Three Kings Sunday. This is the Sunday that we celebrate the day that the Three Kings came and visited Jesus after his birth, right? And they brought him the gifts of the gold and the frankincense and the myrrh. We've probably heard this story before, right? But we're going to look at that text. I think it has a lot to say about our worship. So I'm going to be reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. So it says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I too may come and worship him.' After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way." So, Jesus is born, right? Christmas. Now we're moving on. The news of his birth is beginning to spread. So we've all seen a nativity scene, right? And we've seen the three wise men who just walk along and they drop off their gifts to Jesus, just like it is Christmas. And that's a really nice picture for a nativity scene. But the reality is that the situation is a lot more complex than that, all right? So let's dig in a little bit deeper. So these three men have traveled from the east, probably hundreds of miles. Right? They hear that there is a king of the Jews to be born somewhere, and that's a big deal to them, which is a little bit weird because they are not Jewish. right? But they hear a king of the Jews is going to be born. So they go to Herod, who is the current king of the Jews, and they say, hey, who is this baby that is going to be born and where can we find him? And he freaks out because sounds like somebody's trying to take his throne. So he is trying to use them as a pawn in his scheme to become a more powerful king. He says, tell me where the baby is. I'll go worship him myself. He really wants to have the baby killed. So this situation is intense. Herod was a corrupt and oppressive and a bloodthirsty ruler. And somehow the wise men get caught up in this when they're just trying to go worship the king of the Jews. So, that aside, they find Jesus and they worship him, right? The word in here in this original language literally means falling to your knees, face down, in awe and reverence. Can you imagine that? Like, these men aren't even Jews. They don't have that personal, that longing, that yearning that the Jews felt, that for hundreds of years they were waiting in anticipation of a Messiah to come. And even still, they find the Messiah in the form of an infant, the baby Jesus, perhaps a year or two old, but even still, brought to their knees. Wow. So they bring him gifts, right? They're gold and frankincense and myrrh. These are not just the gifts under $20 that you find on the Amazon website. These are real gifts for a king. And it's hard to know just how much these gifts are worth, because we don't know how much they had or whatever, but scholars estimate anywhere from a few thousand to a few million dollars. So these are gifts literally for a king, right? So the fact is that they find Jesus here, the long-awaited Messiah, the King of the Jews, but Jesus is still only a child, right? All of these problems that they had and that were going on, this weird political situation and the history of Israel who's waiting for a king, all of that doesn't go away just because Jesus is born. But still, they fall on their face and worship him, and they give him these gifts of just immeasurable value. Because true worship always involves an element of sacrifice, right? So they're sacrificing with their whole bodies, with their time, with their monetary gifts. Everything is the sacrifice and an expression of heartfelt emotion. And that's not always easy, right? Right? And this is the first example of worship that we find in the New Testament. And this sets a really high precedent for the example that we're supposed to follow. But shoot, that's humbling, right? Like, what? It makes me wonder, what are we bringing to the table? Are we doing our best to give God our gold and frankincense and myrrh, our fall to our knees in worship, face down in awe and reverence? Are we giving God the best of our time? Are we prioritizing that intimate relationship by spending time in scripture and in prayer and in meditation? And not just like, I gotta go read my Bible, it's the end of the day and I almost forgot, but actually saying, this is the best and most important part of my life. Are we worshiping God through our finances, contributing to the church and to other causes of contributing to people in need? Or are we spending money on a lot of material things that we may not need? Are we worshiping God in the witness that we show to others? Right? So that's the story of the Epiphany. And there's a lot going on there in our expectations of worship and what we ought to be giving of ourselves in worship. But I want to zoom out a little bit and get a little bit more context, right? So I want to look at Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 6. So this was written about 500 years ago, all right? So picture that. All right. So I'm reading Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 6. And I'm reading out of the ESV. It says, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And the nations shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see, they all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be carried on the hip. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your hearts shall thrill and exult, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall come over you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah, and all those from Sheba shall come, and they shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall bring good news, the praises of the Lord." What a beautiful promise that is from the Lord. Light is coming. Darkness and darkness and darkness, and we've been in the darkness, but the light is coming, and everybody's going to come because of your light. What a beautiful image. So this book of Isaiah, along with the other prophets, like I said, was written about 500, 600 years before Jesus. And it tells a story of the Israelites who just couldn't get it right. They mess up, they're disobedient to God over and over and over again. They end up in exile, right? And so this passage is them coming out of exile. And now they have to rebuild. So this is kind of a weird message to get, right? That in that situation of, here I am coming out of exile, I have nothing. Our families have nothing. We have no resources. We have to rebuild our entire lives from the ground up. And we're told, oh, there's light coming, but the darkness is what's hanging over their heads right now. You know, and we hear these promises of light is coming, and that's so beautiful, but like the present reality is not that. Verse 6 talks about those bringing gold and frankincense and bringing good news and the praises of the Lord, and potentially that's pointing us to the story of the Magi. Perhaps not, but either way, it is a guard. It is a point. Some pointing to something good that is coming, right? And we see all this light imagery, and we know that that's talking about the Messiah that is to come. And they have this hope of the coming one who's going to save them and offer salvation. But Jesus isn't born for another 500 years. And they're coming out of this dark place, and they're hoping for something that's going to come. But they're commanded to arise and shine when their problems are still not solved. And we would love, right, for all of our situations to just be like clean and happy, and then we'll worship. Okay, everything's good, and let's all turn on the music and have a good time. But this command to worship isn't that. It's not shut everything down, forget all of that sadness, be happy. It by no means diminishes the need for the Israelites to lament, to grieve the losses that they've suffered. The truth here is that lament can be a form of worship. If you look at the Psalms, a whole bunch of them are lament. Lament doesn't mean that we don't have joy in our salvation or that we're just depressed and desolate. We see lament in the Bible. We see attention, right? We see people crying for help and saying, all of this injustice is going on. All of these things are going wrong in my life. But here, God, I'm going to trust you. And that tension is palpable in the emotions of the lament. But that happens all over the place throughout Scripture. And operating in that tension is palpable in Scripture, and it's palpable in our real lives. For me, the greatest season of lament that I walked through was my senior year of high school, when a good friend of mine, was a dear member of our church family, passed away. And I remember vividly the Sunday that her family decided to take her off of life support. And all of us and our youth group who were close to her, we all wanted to still gather that day. And I remember meeting in that room. Nobody said hardly a word, and we all just sat there and wept and held each other as we cried, silently praying all sorts of things to God. And the presence of God in that room and the hearts crying out to God, that spirit-filled presence was just as strong in that room that day, or stronger than any other fun worship concert experience I've ever been a part of. And those joyful mountaintop places of worship are awesome. And if that is the place that you are in, celebrate it. And that's something to thank God for, absolutely. But there is no doubt in my mind that God hears those cries of lament just as clearly as God hears those cries of joy. And you know, in this text, in Isaiah, God is saying, "Arise, shine, your light has come, the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." But God knows what's going on. This isn't God saying, "Shove it down, worship. It's Sunday morning, put a smile on, save all of that sadness for 2 p.m., right? The God of the Israelites here is the same God who, in the form of Jesus Christ, wept over the death of his friend Lazarus. It is the same God who told the Samaritan woman that true worship is worship in spirit and in truth. And sometimes that truth is being authentic and honest about the circumstances that we're facing. And this is God saying, "Yes, you are in the darkness and I see you here. But in the darkness, worship." When the Magi come across Jesus, they drop everything and fall to their knees. Their situation is weird. It doesn't matter. They drop everything and they fall to their knees, face down, worship God, recognizing that even in the form of an infant, Jesus Christ is King and Lord. The Israelites coming out of exile, they're called to recognize the darkness that they faced and be honest about that, but to lift their eyes, to take heart for the coming glory. We often find ourselves in a similar tension. You know, we know that Jesus will come again, and we have hope in eternal life, and that is the heart of our faith, is that hope that we have. But we live in a world that is broken, and that can be exhausting. You know, we're facing immeasurable loss. This year has been hard, and we have all felt that. And God sees us in that place. And yet, in our struggle, the greatest miracle of all is that our God is Emmanuel, God with us. God doesn't just sit in heaven coldly looking down on us. We serve a God who chose to step into our brokenness, to meet us at our cries of lament, and in our worship of giving everything that we have, our time and ourselves, all to him. And God reassures us that ultimately, in the end, after all this darkness goes away, he will turn our mourning into joy. Will you pray with me? God, I thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to gather in some form or another. God, I thank you that we live in a community, we exist in this community where we can come to one another fully honest about the things that we're facing. And God, I pray that we would learn to come together to support one another in those places of hurt, to come to you with everything that we have, God. I pray that our lament would be honoring to you, that we would be able to live well in that tension of saying the place that we're at is hard and I don't need to pretend that it isn't, but God, that you are sovereign in all of it. And God, I pray that you would be glorified in that honesty, and that honest place would strengthen our witness, that we would bring others closer to you. God, I praise you for who you are and for the strength that you give us, that you strengthen us to be steadfast and to abide and to press on towards the goal of building your kingdom and ultimately meeting you again in glory. God, we love you and we thank you for everything that you've done for us. In your name, amen.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please take a moment to offer up your silent prayers of confession. Please take a moment to wrap up your prayers. Please look at me. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God. Amen. Now, if we were together in person, this would be the time that we would offer one another signs of reconciliation of love through passing the peace of Christ. If you are living with other people in your home, hit pause and take a moment to pass the peace of Christ. If you live alone, I invite you, hit pause and call a friend and pass the peace of Christ. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth or you had formed the earth, from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where the Christ was born, and in your signs and witnesses in every age and through all the world, you have led your people from far places to his light. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all who are worshiping online, and on these gifts of bread and wine, and on the gifts of bread and wine in our homes. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And all God's children say, Amen. And now, with the confidence in knowing that we are the children of God, let us pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The body of Christ, broken for you. Eat and be thankful. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Drink and be thankful.
Save a world so cold and hollow.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Friends, my prayer for you is that you would be blessed by the warmth and love of a God who wraps his arms around you in your grief, in your mourning, and he holds you and sits with you there, and that he turns your mourning into joy. And I pray that you would be able to turn that around into adoration and awe and reverence of the Lord, and that you would go forth into the world giving everything that you have to him. Amen.
Worship.